Hello all, welcome to this lecture series on organizational behavior. We are in the second lecture, which is on organizational behavior and introduction. So in the first lecture, I was talking to you about the definition of organizational behavior. So in order to understand the definition of organizational behavior, we looked at the definitions of organization, behavior, and organizational behavior. In fact, while defining all these three concepts, we looked at the complexities in defining these concepts. In fact, I was trying to challenge each one of those terms used in the term organization. We spent a lot of time in understanding the terminologies used to define organization. The objective of making things complex for you is not to confuse you, but to make you understand how the idea of organization is very difficult to understand. Even with lot of effort to define it systematically, many of these ideas can be relative in nature. So how will this understanding that there is a complexity in defining organization will help you in this course? One, it will help you understand how newer forms of organizations are emerging and how these newer forms of organizations are influencing the way people behave in organizations. Two, this understanding of complexity will help you look at things critically, or it will help you think critically. So even though there are a lot of theories which are based on many years of empirical work, those are context specific. So without understanding the context, or without specifying the context, we cannot generalize any phenomena or any knowledge. So I was trying to make you be critical about the context in which these research or these theories are made. So when we talk about theories to understand human behavior in later slides or in later chapters, you will try to look at them critically by understanding their context, or understanding the credibility of those theories in a particular situation. Okay, so knowledge is not necessarily knowing, knowledge is also critically evaluating, or evaluating with rationality. Okay, so like I said, we were trying to understand what is an organization, what is behavior, and what is organizational behavior. If you remember, I gave you a homework. I asked you to think about certain thing, which is country. I want you to answer me whether you will classify country as a social group, whether it is an organization or not. Okay, the right answer is country is not an organization. Let's go back to the definition. So if in fact country is not an organization, government is the organization. Why country is not organization? Because country is not a consciously coordinated social entity. In other words, there are no clear-cut job descriptions or task descriptions prescribed to citizens. So let's say if you are a student in an institute, you are also a citizen of that particular, or you are also a member of that particular institute. But how your membership as a student is different from your membership as a citizen in a country? One, your membership as a student in an institute, you have, like I said, you have clear cut descriptions of what you have to do and what you should not do. Okay, there are certain things which are expected from you, and they are written down. But in a country, your role as a citizen, so being a citizen is a role, which means there are no clear-cut descriptions of what you have to do and what you cannot do. There are rules, but these rules help us govern or help us live in this country with less problems, or cooperate as a society as a whole, but not as specific demands which are placed on you. So one country cannot be strictly called as a consciously coordinated social entity. Two, the idea of common goal or goals. Again, these goals of a country are vaguely prescribed or very broadly prescribed, unlike an organization. So the idea of goal in terms of common goal is not very rigid for a country. Okay, but otherwise size is not a factor. In fact, there are organizations which are bigger than some countries in the world. So size cannot be a criteria to evaluate whether a country is a organization or not. Okay, I think I made things clear. So country cannot be called as an organization. It is a political entity, and government which governs the country is the organization. Okay. So I think you are clear about what I said about whether country is an organization or not. Okay. So we also looked at organizational behavior, defined what is organizational behavior. In fact, this is where we stopped in the previous lecture. So one thing I didn't mention is OBE has a multidisciplinary area. So what is multidisciplinarity means? So OBE involves inputs from different disciplines. Disciplines like psychology, sociology, anthropology, management, many various economics, many various fields contribute to organizational behavior as a discipline. In fact, psychology is a major contributor to the field of organizational behavior. A very fundamental question which most people or most managers have is how to make people give their 100%. Okay, so basically there are two different ways to understand people's behavior at work. One, you need managers to push people to perform, or people are inherently lazy in nature, and unless and until you push them, they may not perform. The second assumption is employees per se are motivated people to work. Sometimes they may not work because they don't feel meaningfulness or purpose in what they do. Okay, there are two ways of looking at employee behavior in workplace. Which one is true? We'll talk about it in our later chapter on motivation. OBE as a discipline has certain basic assumptions. Or in other words, OBE, organizational behavior as a discipline, assumes certain things to be true. And only based on those assumptions, other theories or other models are built upon. Okay, so according to me, or based on my understanding of organizational behavior, these are some of the assumptions OBE makes. One, organization consists of people. Agreed? In fact, in the definition we saw, definition of organization, we saw at least one person should be there to define an organization. In fact, there are organizations which range from one person to tens and thousands of people. Okay. Agreed? Okay. Two, motivated people work effectively. Agree? Anybody here who wants to disagree with this statement? So many of us think that people who are motivated work well. Okay. So in other words, happy people perform better. Agreed? One simple way of explaining the second statement is happy people work well. Okay. Is it true? Happy people work well? In fact, this is a very commonsensical idea. If you are happy in your work, you will work well. But again, if you want to look at this statement critically, if you want to try to understand the context in which it is true, there are some challenges in understanding the statement. One, if you look at this statement, you need to understand it doesn't say people who are happy with their work better than others, or they perform better than others. No, it's not what the statement says. So this statement says motivated people work effectively. So here you have to understand the difference between effectiveness and efficiency. Okay, just pass on for a minute. Think about, you would have heard these terms, isn't it? Effectiveness, efficiency. Think about these two terms and what is the difference? So, motivated people may work effectively, but not necessarily efficiently. Okay, so what is the difference? Effectiveness and efficiency. Maybe in your engineering classes also you would have studied, if you're an engineering student, you would have heard these terms, isn't it? Effectiveness and efficiency. Okay, I'll explain what is the difference. Effectiveness means doing things in a better way or achieving the goals which are worth achieving. Okay, efficiency is more output for less input, or in other words, you are able to give an optimal output for a particular input. I'll give an example. Let's say I spend 2 hours in playing a video game and I'm able to score more than others, okay, in terms of getting points in that video game. So I might be very efficient in playing the video game or the computer game. But if you ask the question, does playing video game add value to me? Is it a goal which is worth achieving? So I have not used my time effectively. Okay. So this is the difference. So effectiveness is achieving a goal which is worth achieving, or achieving the right kind of goals. Efficiency is achieving a certain goal with minimum effort or with optimal effort. Okay, the goal may not be important. So here what it says is motivated people work effectively, which means if somebody is motivated, they will do things for the organization which is good for the organization. Okay, so they will try to help, or they will try to perform in a way that adds value to the organization. So what is the problem in taking performance as a criteria, just how much they have performed in their work? The problem with performance is performance depends on various other factors than motivation. So a motivated employee will be willing to work for more time or put more effort, but if the environment in which he or she works is not conducive, or if he or she is not getting the right kind of tools or resources, then their performance will not be good, or they may not be able to perform to their fullest. So performance as a criteria is a very questionable criteria. But in what ways does motivated people contribute? So motivated people contribute in other performances. So they are called extra role performance. So extra role performance means doing things which are not prescribed in their work, or going above what is expected from them in their job. For example, helping their coworker even though it is not required, even though if it is not expected from you, following the rules even when nobody is observing, things like that. Okay, the third point: disparity between organizational and individual goals. In fact, this also we saw in our first lecture, where we looked at when we define goals of the organization, there can be multiple goals. So the inherent problem with managing an organization or managing people in the organization is aligning these goals together. So there are multiple groups within the organization, multiple stakeholders, each one of them have their own goals. So the challenge of a manager is to make people align their goals with organizational goals. So they have to see the connection between their goals and the larger organizational goals. For example, if my company makes a lot of profit, but it doesn't provide me job security, okay? So I will not be motivated towards helping my organization make large profits. So only when organizations understand what individual employees want, then they can help them, or they can convince their employees that these goals, individual goals, are possible only when organizations achieve their goals, or in other way around, Only when organization achieves the larger goals, individual goals can be achieved. Okay. See, the fourth point, impact of policies and procedures on people are not always predictable. So organizational behavior assumes that individuals are different. Each individual is different in his or her own in his or her own sake. So a policy will create different kinds of reactions among different kinds of people. Okay. For example, my organization brings in a policy of working from home. So it says you don't need to travel every day for work. You can stay at home and work. Not everyone will be happy with this kind of a policy. Even though it is a good policy for most people, some people may not prefer to work from home. So you need to understand what individual employees want or what is their expectation or motivation, and then you need to frame policies and procedures. So this is what makes this is a very important challenge managers face. So organizational behavior also tries to acknowledge these issues and try to resolve them or help managers resolve them in a better way. So some of the fundamental ideas, some of the basic concepts which OB uses to explain behavior. One, each individual is different. So like I said, mentioned earlier, each one of us is different in our own way. But again, if each one of us is different, how can you make judgments, or how can you generalize? How can you generalize behaviors, or how can you predict behavior if each one of us are different? Okay, this is again an interesting question to ask. So it also means, what is the point of coming up with experiments, theories, because you cannot generalize them to other context. If you remember, I was telling you we need to critically look at theories and research. So this is one critique on understanding human behavior as a true scientific endeavor. Okay, so humans are not physical things. Humans are psychological or social beings. Humans are also physical beings, but psychology and sociology of humans overpower many physiological things. Okay, so when each individual is different, how can you generalize things? So one answer to this is acknowledging the fact that each individual is different itself is a knowledge which helps us understand behavior through a certain context. Okay, for example, in a larger context of culture. So if you are meeting someone for the first time, should you shake hands or should you hug them or should you say namaste? Okay, so there is no one answer to it. So the answer is it depends on the context. It depends on the larger cultural context, the age of the gender, age or level, all these factors. So organizational behavior as a discipline helps us understand not just individuals but also the surrounding context, and through that understand individual behavior. Okay, the second point, employees have multiple roles. So what does it mean? You can have a particular designation in an organization, but like I said earlier, your designation prescribes a certain things which are expected from you, but it doesn't mean that is the single path or the single description you have in your hand. So there are multiple role expectations. So I will explain what is the difference between role and a designation. Role is social expectation on an individual. Designation is a written position or a position which is given to you. Okay. For example, my designation is associate professor currently, but my role is a teacher. I have multiple roles in this designation. One role is teacher, another role is PhD guide, maybe another role is a researcher, another role is maybe if I have some administrative positions in my institute. So those are different roles which I play. So when people play multiple roles, they also encounter role conflicts. Okay, so role conflicts can be of two types. inter role conflict and intra role conflict. So inter role conflict means between roles. For example, I'm a PhD guide and also I am a teacher. Okay, so work demands from two different roles or work demands from multiple roles can create burden on me, role burden. Role conflict can also be, inter-role conflict can also be two different roles expecting contradictory things from me. For example, if I'm a counselor, as a psychology teacher, I can also counsel students. I'm a counselor at the same time, I'm also teaching the same student. So, you know, I'm playing two different roles to this particular student, as a psychological counselor, as a teacher. So, you know, maybe let's say the student's undergoing certain trouble in his or her personal life. So should I be lenient as a teacher or should I be empathetic as a counselor? So these are some of the inter-role conflicts people face. There can also be intra-role conflict, which means within the same role, there might be multiple expectations. For example, you know, as a teacher, some students may perceive me as just an instructor. Some students may expect me to be a guru kind of a person who intervenes or take personal care in what they are learning. So the same role can have multiple expectations. So this understanding of people having multiple roles, how does it help? One, you'll understand there is conflict. Two, when you are designing or when you are trying to make policies in terms of creating jobs or job descriptions, you should be careful about these inter-role or intra-role conflicts or burdens in the job roles. Okay, so the third point is motivation is a force behind employee performance or effectiveness of employees. So which means when employees are motivated, they perform effectively. In fact, work effectiveness is more important than work efficiency, because effective employees help organizations sustain their profits for a very long time. So they question, they put an extra effort, they go for, they are very loyal and things like that. Okay. The last point here is human dignity, which means organizational behavior as a discipline or a systematic way of understanding human behavior in workplace is not just about, you know, manipulating people to perform better in their work. So it's not about, you know, making people work more or making people be more productive. It is about it, but not through, controlling things, or it's not like, you know, you are manipulating or changing certain things so that people act accordingly. So the basic idea here is, fundamental idea here is, you should respect human dignity. Humans are like any other living beings, demand respect, demand dignity or deserve dignity. So you cannot treat them as experimental subjects or just, you know, some number. So organizational behavior keeps this in mind so that it as a discipline, it is more ethical and more humane. Okay. So with this, we'll stop today's this particular lecture session. So like I said earlier, organizational behavior is of multiple levels. Human behavior involves or is influenced by different factors, or understanding human behavior can be at different contexts or different levels. So what are these levels? One, at a very basic individual level, trying to understand people about their personality, attitude, motivation, things like that. And the second level is understanding these concepts in a group level. So why people behave in a certain way in certain teams, or when there is a conflict between two people, why individuals or what stance people might take, or what kind of people take leadership positions? Is there anything related to personality which affects leadership qualities, or whether attitudes decide leadership qualities? So these are some of the questions where individual processes will influence the group processes. At the larger level, these smaller units of individual processes and group processes can also influence larger organizational processes. Like, you know, individuals influencing how an organization behaves, or how an organization undergoes a change management initiative, or how culture of an organization is built by individual attitudes and motivation. So these are different levels through which behavior influences different processes. But again, the question is it top down or bottom up? So I think I will leave it there. This is going to be your point to ponder for the next lecture. So I want you to think whether larger processes like organizational processes influence individual behavior, or individuals change the larger organizational processes. So the question here is, can individuals change larger social groups, or larger social groups have more power over individual behavior? Okay, just think about it. We will talk about this question in our next lecture. Okay, see you then. Bye.